Fantastic.
Amen.
Thank God that I can stand before you today. It's a privilege to talk to God's children. Our sermon this morning is entitled, Let Every Lamb Be Valuable. Each one of us, we are a vessel of Christ. We are an instrument to be used by Christ. I am a lamb. You are a lamb. Are you burning for Christ? Am I burning for Christ? Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, as you are speaking to us this morning, be with each one of us. Let your Holy Spirit to steer our hearts that we hear what you have prepared for us to hear. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. Just 2 weeks ago, that's when I was taught, I was standing before you today. It was a privilege to come and preach. By God's grace, I accepted the challenge.
Yeah.
And I was well. But unfortunately, soon after, I started coughing. Like I was so sick that I was saying, will I make it? But it was 2 weeks apart off. Then I said, cough is usually before this, then it's good. Indeed, they were sealed a week later. Then come this week, just Wednesday, I was so sick, I didn't even go to work. My voice was totally gone. Then I said, something must be going on. But I'll still make it to church. Because I said, I have 2 days to be healed. Then I prayed to God. I asked others to pray for me. That I'm sick, but on Sabbath, I have to go and speak to those children. So pray for me that I get healed, that I can be able to talk to those children. And praise God, here I am talking to you. I'm well.
Amen.
Amen. Okay. We'll start our sermon this morning by looking at Matthew chapter 5, verse 18 to 15. Go through up to 16. Matthew chapter 5, verse 18 to 16.
Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men.
Verse 14. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden.
Verse 15.
Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Verse 16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven.
Amen. In these two verses, we are urged as Christians, one, to be salt to the world, and secondly, to be light of the world. So we have been given two responsibilities as Christians. And on verse 16, that's when it is saying that when we are the light and salt, that's only when the good works in us can be shown to people, and as a result, we glorify our Father who art in heaven. Let me turn to desires of ages, page 307, paragraph 1. True character is not shaped from without and put on. It radiates from within. If we wish to direct others in the path of righteousness, the principles of righteousness must be enriched in our own hearts. Our profession of faith may proclaim the theory of religion, but it is our practical piety that puts forth the word of truth. The consistent life, the holy organization, the unswerving integrity, the active benevolent spirit, the bodily example, these are the mediums through which light is conveyed to the world. So, from this passage, we see that it is our character which is defining salt and light. A true character of God that is instilled in our hearts, that's only when the good works can be shown from us. Salt, as salt which we use in our food, can be used various ways. It can be used as a seasoning or a spice. It can also be used as a preservative. These are the characters that as Christians we should show to others. A seasoning, a spice, makes food a little bit good than not putting salt in it. So as Christians, living around others, are we making those people know how good God is, knowing how loving God is through our characters, what really is inside us? Are we being the seasoning which God requires of us, which from the passage has said? Are we living a consistent life, our conversations only? Are we honest? So through these things, that's when we can be sought to the world, when our characters have been changed, true characters of God. And it says also in the passage that we cannot direct others in the path of righteousness when we ourselves are not practicing the principles of righteousness. We are urged that we should be also practicing these things. And so, is also used as a preservative. A preservative, it keeps things longer than without it. It can go bad, it can rot. But salt, it preserves and keeps the things a lot longer than without it. So as Christians, are we preserving the truth? Can people see in our lives that we are beholding the truth that is in the Bible? What we believe in, the 28 fundamental beliefs, are we truly practicing all that in our lives? Are those things embedded in our lives, and they are part of us, part of our characters? And we are also urged to be light. Light shines through darkness. Now, the sun comes up. It is the light that has taken away the darkness of the night. Our lives shining through others who are in darkness, that when we come into their lives, they see a difference. They have the hope that things will change because we have come to help them. And also, They are in the darkness of sin, And when we come up, they see how sinful they are. And they tend to think, no, am I doing the right thing for God? They tend to ask questions when they see how we are conducting. Just by conducting ourselves, they see how far away they are from God. I'm reading from this Isaiah of Ages, page 108. And it reads, warn every soul that is in danger. Leave none to deceive themselves. Call sin by its right name. Declare what God has said in regard to lying, Sabbath breaking, stealing, idolatry, and every other evil. So as we are the light to the world, as we are shining through the darkness, let us warn the souls that we are meeting along the way, as the quote is saying of the Zion of Ages. Our Lord requires of us nothing less than to be salt, to make a difference in people's lives. And also, on top of that, to warn them of the soon coming dangers. We all know that we are living in the last days. The world is not what it was, or even 5 years ago. Things are moving fast. Are we challenging ourselves to be salt and light to the world? The Lord requires us to be hot Christians. Because if we are warm, even warm, we are going to be spit out. Even in verse 13, if I can read that, it says, ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost its favor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. So if we lose this responsibility of ours, we are going to be set aside. Because it's a choice that each and every one of us has to make. So if we have chosen not to be sold, the Lord will respect our decisions and will be set aside. But we are all here to say, no, Lord, I want to be sold again. I want to be light. That is why we come together, come to church, to hear what the Lord has prepared for us, and even at our homes and wherever we are, we still call upon God's name that we be salt and light of the world. But how can we be salt and light? I've come with 3 points that can help us to be the salt and light, and that we should not lose value, or even our lamps should go out. How can we burn our lamps, our candlesticks? Because we are it that we have to be uphill. People should notice us. People should know that there is someone here who is a Seventh-day Adventist, whose lives are different from the rest of the world. We are not blended with the darkness of the world, but we are shining forth. We are bringing a flavor to people's life that they cannot just stay quiet, but to say, there is someone near me. So, what can help us to be salt forevermore? How can we help us to be light forevermore? Because Matthew 24, verse 18 is who are forever, to stay the way we are forever. So, one of the points is on Acts chapter 1, verse 14. We can ask Asante to read it for us.
Acts chapter 1, verse 14. It reads, "These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication, with the woman and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers."
From this verse, we see this was the time when the Lord has just left the disciples when he went to heaven. But when they stayed here again, they continued in prayer. So prayer is the most important thing in our lives, for us to be salt, for us to be light, for us to be part of our life. We need prayer to be one of our characters, to be prayerful individuals. Also read for us Mark chapter 9, verse 29.
Mark chapter 9, verse 29. "So he said to them, this tide can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting."
It is only by prayer and fasting. That's when we can continue to be salt and light to the world. On chapter 9, Jesus healed a demonic child, and he continued to stay on verse 29, that only by prayer and fasting, that's when we can cast out these demons. So we are urged from Matthew chapter 5 that we have to be the light of the world. We have to take out the darkness that is in people. So one way of it is that we ourselves must be committed in prayer and fasting, praying for God's guidance as we are going along the way, to help us, to mold us in characters that is useful for others. Praying for forgiveness of sins, that we cleanse our robes spotless. Because when going forth, we are saying that we have to be righteous. We have to, we ourselves, to be righteous, to practice the principles of righteousness. That's when, only when, we can be the light of the world. And we also have to pray for strength, that we are not going to go backwards. We are not going to backslide. So we need the strength for God to help us to indeed remain in his word. We have to pray for a changed heart. Praying that we are not conformed to the world, but we are to be transformed by renewing of our minds. To continuing is that we are not to pray for ourselves, but to pray for those that we are going to meet along the way. That whatever it is that we are going to say to them, it should be something that it will take them closer to God and not us. Read for us James chapter 5, verse 16.
James chapter 5, verse 16. "Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much."
James 5, verse 16 is teaching us to pray for one another because it brings forth healing. So when you're praying for yourselves, when you're praying for others, you know how much it is you have to pray for yourselves. Because when you're praying for someone who maybe to be healed, you also say, "No, I'm not feeling well, I have to be healed." You're praying for someone troubled in a sin. When you're also in that same sin, you first face it. So when you're praying for others, you also get healed along the way. And we also have to fast. As we are living in the last days, the world is offering us so many things, and other things to be honest, are distracting us from the grand prize which the Lord has promised each one of us, which is eternal life. We need to fast things the world is offering us, which are distracting us. Social media is doing a lot of distraction. Not that it is bad on its own, but the things that are seen in social media, the time that we are spending, when we compare that, how much have I spent with God and how much we have spent with social media, when we put it in the balance, we'll find out that we are wanting. And when I was preparing this sermon, it also spoke to me. We have to fast foods that are destroying our health. We have to fast from evil influences. We all know that bad company corrupts good company. So we have to make sure that when we are going out, we have to forsake all evil influences that is surrounding us. I want to read the quote from Steps to Christ, page 70. Concentrate yourselves to God in the morning. Make this your very first work. Let your prayer be, take me, O Lord, as holy man. I lay all my plans at thy feet. Use me to thee in thy service. Abide with me, and let all my work be brought in this. This is a daily matter. Each morning, concentrate yourself to God for that day. Surrender all your plans to him. To be carried out or given up at his providence shall indicate. Thus, day by day, you may be giving your life into the hands of God. And thus, your love will be more than more and more after the life of Christ. Prayer will make us be like Jesus, will be molded after the life of Jesus, will be how to make us have true characters, characters of salt and light. Also reading from prayer, the book of prayer, page 270. Paragraph 1, it reads, if the Savior of men, with his divine strength, felt the need of prayer, how much more should feeble, sinful mortals feel the necessity of prayer? Fervent, constant prayer. When Christ was the most fiercely beset by temptation, he ate nothing. He committed himself to God, and through endless prayer and perfect submission to the will of his Father, came off conqueror. Those who profess the truth for these last days, above every other class of professed Christians, should imitate the great example in prayer. We have to be prayerful Christians, continuing, another way in which we are to remain, to be salt and light, is to spend much time in reading God's word. Read for us Timothy. At 2 Timothy, chapter 3, verse 15 to 17.
2 Timothy, chapter 3, verse 15. And that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof,
for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Scripture, that's when we know we have to make a correction somewhere in our lives. When you're reading the Word of God, that's when we will know I'm not doing well. When we are done talking to Him through prayer, it is now time to let God speak to us now what is required for us now. So for God to speak to us, we have to use the Bible, the Word of God, also the testimonies of Christ, which is the inspired readings of Ellen G. White. Those also are God's words. We need to read, to spend precious time in reading God's word, because that's when we know what is required of us, how God wants us to conduct ourselves. We need to let God talk to us through the word of God. There is nothing more calculated to energize the mind and strengthen the intellect than the study of the Word of God. No other book is so potent to elevate the thoughts, to give vigor to the faculties as the broad, ennobling truth of the Bible. If God's words were studied as it should be, men would have the breadth of mind, a nobility of character, and a stability of purpose that are nearly the same in these times. The search for truth will reward the seeker at every turn, and each discovery will be opening up richer fields for his investigation. So, in this quote, this is from Call to Stand Up, a call to stand apart, page 69, paragraph 2. It is only when we are reading the Word of God, when our minds will be like Jesus. Our characters will be modeled like Jesus. We'll have a stability of purpose. The purpose which we have read on Matthew chapter 5, verse 18 and 16, that we are to be sought and to be the light. So we have this stability of purpose only when we are reading His word. If we also read John 5, John chapter 5, verse 89.
John chapter 5, verse 39, you search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me.
In scriptures, that's where we can find eternal life. No man can rightly present the law of God without the gospel, or the gospel without the law. The law is the gospel embodied, and the gospel is the law unfolded. The law is the root, the gospel is the fragrant blossom, and the fruit which it bears. So by beholding, we become. When we are reading the word of God, we will be molded to what the Bible is saying for us Christians. And the last point that I had, for us to remain burning for Christ, for us to remain sought of the world, for us to be constant in these purposes, we are now to come together as Christians, to fellowship one another. Because that's when we come together, that's when we can light the brightest. When I bring my light, when you bring your light, When all of us are springing our life, that's when we can cry the brightest to the world. There is strength in unity. Read for us Acts chapter 2, verse 1 to 4.
Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance.
When the former rains came, when the Holy Spirit during the apostles' time came, they were in one accord. They were unified, they were together. So only when we are unified, come together, when you pray, when you read your personal Bible studies, when you come together now to speak of the word of God, that's when we'll be united with the Lord. That's when we'll experience our uttering. I'll continue to read from the same chapter, verse 44 and 47.
Verse 44. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved.
They continued. They didn't just stop to receive the former, but they continued to be one accord until they went to the world. So we are going to the world, yes, as individuals, but we are also being called upon to go out as one church, going out to the world, being shining bright as we have brought so many lights together, brightening to the world, making a difference to the world together. Finally, for us, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25.
Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as in the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching.
So as we see the days approaching of our soon return of our Lord Jesus Christ, that's when we should now come together openly to speak about Jesus Christ, to witness to one another. Because I don't know what the Lord has done for you this week. But when we come together, that's when we'll shine the brightest. That's when I'll be molded in the character of Christ, because I know what the Lord is doing in your life. So I'll believe that He will do the same in my life. So as we approach the end scenes of the earth, we are urged as Christians to come together as one. Unity, there is power in unity. I'm reading my last accord of the day, which is Christ of the place of page 120 and 21. One interest rebelled, one object swallowed up all others, all hearts beat in harmony. The only ambition of the believers was to reveal the likeness of Christ's character, and to labor for the enlargement of His kingdom. The Spirit of Christ animated the whole congregation, for they had found the pearl of great price. These scenes had been repeated, and with greater power. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost was the former rain, but the latter rain will be more abundant. Christ is again to be revealed in his fullness by the Holy Spirit. One interest, one object, one. All hearts beat in harmony. And this time around, God promises us that we will be with great power. Let us be part of this grand occasion to receive this grant, which God has promised us, that those who live in the last days will have it. But only those that are salt and light for the world. Only those that our characters are true. Only those that are practicing the principles of righteousness. In closing, as I was preparing my sermon today, I came across hymn number 595. I don't know how to sang. So I just want to read with you, because when I went through it, my heart was touched. Let every lamp be burning bright. The darkness hour is near. The darkness hour is long night before the Lord's appearing. Then trim your lamps, my brethren dear. Then trim your lamps with godly faith. The Master's coming draweth near. Let every lamp be burning. Though thousands come slumber on, the last great message spanning, we'll rest our daily faith upon his promise of returning. His word our lamp, his truth our guide. We cannot be mistaken. Though dangers rise on every side, we shall not be forsaken. Then let good works with faith appear to help the world around us. Obedience brings the blessings near. When faith has firmly about us, then trim your lamps, my brethren. Then trim your lamps with God in faith. The Master's coming draweth near. Let every lamp be burning. Amen.